this is one of the most exciting parts of the course, in my opinion. While our textbook does not address Egyptian art as such, the Egyptians were a group of people who had a genius instinct. The Egyptians. And we want to look at the genius of the Egyptian people. 2,500 years BC, that means it's 4,500 years ago, these people, who happened to have been black people prior to Alexander the Great ruling as pharaoh and then Europeans being on the throne, but prior to that time, most of all of the kings were of what we call Negroid extraction. The anthropologists used to put all kinds of people into just three categories: Mongoloid, Negroid, and Caucasian. It so happens that most of those pharaohs living in a hot climate like that were brown skin, they had coarse hair, had thick lips, and would fall into what the anthropologists call the Negroid group of people. But as we will see momentarily, they don't even use that subject anymore because the world is a diverse mixture of people, and you just can't take three categories and describe everyone in this world. We want to talk about the genius of these people because 95% of Egypt is desert, and only 5% that encompasses the Nile River is water or vegetation. And that meant that all the great things that they did came under pressure, some circumstances. It was 100. I've been there when at 10:30 in the morning, it's 140 degrees outside. Imagine these people who worked in the sun from 4 o'clock or 4 a.m. in the morning all the way through. The Egyptians have given the world so much. And so in this art appreciation course, I can't ignore the genius of the Egyptian people. Our textbook does not give that much emphasis. It shows some Egyptian artwork. But I have to give this full presentation. I think you're going to enjoy every minute of it. First of all, the Egyptians gave us the 365-day year. The Egyptians gave us the 24-hour day. They knew astronomy, and they mastered the area of stacking and piling, building process. The Great Pyramid is one block on top of another, blended together. When we were children, we used to play with blocks, and we would put 5 blocks up, and they'd fall down. But if we took 12 blocks and put 4 together, then put another 4 on top of that, another 4 on top of that, we would have the beginning of what we call a stacking and piling strength process. And so the Egyptians mastered that, and to prove it, the only seventh wonder of the world that exists today that anyone can see that is 5,000 years old, the Great Pyramid of Giza, built with stacking and piling. They knew how to move 2 to 70-ton blocks. They would pull those blocks, and they would, according to calculations, every 2 minutes. You see, it took the Great Pyramid of Giza 200,000 men, 20 years, to build that one pyramid. They also believed in life after death, so they mastered the process of embalming, making people so that they appeared and their bodies appeared to be strong and that you could recognize them. I saw a man in the Egyptian Museum who had been dead for 3,000 years, but the mummification process had made him look like he was sleeping. And so we will talk about that because the Egyptians they believed their whole religion was afterlife. They believed in life after death, and that when a person died, they went into the life that was made for them, and if the pharaoh died, they would be a part of that. We'll get into that a little bit later. Then they found a plant the Egyptians, made of what we call papyrus. And because of that, we have records today, and we have all kinds of knowledge today, because they made a paper called papyrus paper, some of which is found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. They were masters of stone cutting. And finally, they were masters of perfumes and cosmetics, because of that heat in the pores. They had to come up with all kinds of salves, all kinds of perfumes, all kinds of things. And of course, they were masters of that. I guess they're known best for the building of the Great Pyramid. Still exists today, and what you see is what was built some 4,500 years ago, or 2,500 BC. They moved these giant blocks, as you see, and they moved them up ramps, and they were able to build the Great Pyramid of Giza with 1.9 million blocks over 20 years, and it took 200,000 men to do it. As I told you before, we knew about Egyptian art and their life and their beliefs because they would paint on the tombs. Here's a case where we're looking at the god Anubis, which we call the jackal god. And then we have Osiris, and we have the peasants that work for them. But we know much about it. And of course, what you see, the writing all around here, this is called hieroglyphics. So the Egyptian rulers, up until the time of what we, Alexander the Great, and Alexander the Great only lived 33 years. Many people believe he's buried in Egypt. But he placed and divided the world up when he conquered it into four parts, one of which went to Ptolemy. And Ptolemy had a series of sons, and of course, prior to that time, most of the pharaohs were black. Look at Akhenaten here. Look at those lips, and look at the nose, and look at his features. And then look at Nefertiti on the other side, and you see a white oval structure that's on this side over here. This is called one's cartouche. But let's go to what the Webster Dictionary says is Negroid, or these people appeared, of or relating to or being a major human racial classification traditionally distinguished by physical characteristics such as brown to black pigmentation and often tightly curled hair, and including peoples indigenous to sub-Saharan Africa. Then look at the last sentence, no longer in scientific use. Now, the Egyptians develop a means of communication in hieroglyphics, and in this oval right here is the name of Nefertiti, written in hieroglyphics. Now, I don't want anyone to get shook up now, but I'm going to give you the easiest test you ever had a little bit later on, because you're going to write your own cartouche, your first name. And how will you do that? Well, I'm going to give you a chart, and it's going to line up with, and we're going to put these symbols on it. And the Egyptians, they wrote from the top down, as you see here. Hebrew's written from the right to left. English is written from left to right. But the Egyptians and Chinese is written from the top down. So you're going to have an oval. And my wife's name, for an example, is Ruth. So you see the piece here, it looks like lips that are open. That's R. Then we go to the, looks like a nine backwards. That's the U. And then we go to the T, which is like a half moon. And if you notice, there are two T's. I'll explain that in a minute. And then you go to the H, which is this figure up here. And that's it. That's the cartouche. In our home, my wife and I, my cartouche is on, we have in our dining room. It's on a frame piece papyrus paper, but my wife's cartouche is on one side and mine is on the other. My name is Robert, so therefore be R, then O, and then B. And so you don't have to worry about drawing these things. You can even, I'm going to give you a piece of paper like this, and you are going to actually, you can trace it. And you will write your own cartouche, and that's the easiest test you will ever have. But the thing that we want you to know is the truth. One thing about academic achievement, the university came out of the church. Why? Because they were seeking truth. We like truth in academia. And so the truth tells us that the artwork tells us that these people were, in fact, Negroid. And the great thing about the Egypt, we call it the Nile, the gift of the Nile, but it was Herodotus, the one who they said is the father of history. He went to Egypt about the 4th century B.C., and he looked at the Nile and all that it did and all of its power to give food and to give nourishment and give silk, and he called it the gift of the Nile. And if you'll notice, it flows, overflows every year and yields something we call silk, which is sort of like a fertilizer. It's also used to embalm people. So the Nile River is called the gift of the Nile. And Herodotus, the Greek historian, was the one who gave us that quote. The Nile River is the longest river in the world. It's 4,150 miles long. It flows from south to north rather than north to south. In other words, it flows upward. And its headstreams end up in Khartoum, which is today called the Sudan, in the White Nile, the Blue Nile. And then, of course, lately, since the 60s, they built the Aswan Dam. And that's what controls the Nile today from overflowing. But many millions of people are eating and surviving because of the Aswan Dam. This gift of the Nile, this wonderful river, filled with all kinds of fish, filled with all kinds of reptiles, hippos, everything goes on here in this river. People bathe, animals bathe. And this ancient map that you're looking at looks at Egypt in the early days. Now, this is the New Kingdom. The area down here they call Nubia is really Ethiopia today. And notice how the Nile goes up and it's going from south to north through Karnak and through Memphis. But everything is closely built around the Nile because the water source was important for life. And up here in Syria and all this area used to be a part of Egypt. Syria today, Palestine today, and we had the Hittites who challenged the Egyptians in war. But notice it's Nubia. Notice Thebes. And Egypt has had three capitals. First being Memphis, and we'll talk about that later. And that's where the pyramids are located. And then we have Thebes, where the Valley of the Kings is located, or Necropolis, where they hid most of the tombs and where Tutankhamun's tomb was found. And then if you have Abu Simbel, which is the place where Ramses II, or Ramses the Great, built his tomb. So it's ironic here, but Lower Egypt is really what we would call Northern Egypt. And Upper Egypt is really what we would call Southern Egypt. And this is Nubia, which is today known as Ethiopia. The people here are the same that existed some 4,500 years ago. And this young lady, an Egyptian woman, right, lives right near the Nile. They use these boats to fish and to gather food. And if you've noticed, the Nubian people were brown-skinned people. It's very difficult to live in a land or a place like this and not be brown because the vitamin D that is necessary in order to sustain oneself. The ultraviolet rays of the sun are so strong that that pigment, it attracts and preserves. Also, the hair, which is a curly hair, a textured hair, and that's really a protection against the ultraviolet rays of the sun. So here we have these ancient Nubians and this Nubian woman here, and they have not changed. Yet it was the 2500 BC under the pharaoh named Khufu that this great pyramid was built. It was built with mathematical accuracy, and they knew geometry, they knew symmetry, they knew mathematics. They could construct a perfect isosceles triangle like this. The Egyptians, the Nubian pharaohs, is a sample of one. Tahago was, and that was 690 BC, but a Nubian pharaoh. And we knew the pharaohs by their headdress. Some Egypt used to be divided into Upper and Lower Egypt. And Norma was the person who came along, the pharaoh, who combined Upper Egypt and Lower Egypt. Menes was also a founder. But the red crown of Egypt, that looks like a chair down at the bottom, is from Lower Egypt. That's up by Memphis. And then, of course, the white crown, which looks sort of like a bowling pin, that was for Upper Egypt. Then the third one, notice they combined the two so that the double crown is for United Egypt, Upper and Lower Egypt. You can see the red crown is worn by the king on the left, the one that looks like the chair, and they would put into relief form their enemies who they chopped their heads off and put their heads down between their legs. And this is how they presented warfare. The white crown, this was, of course, the symbol of Upper Egypt. And we see the crown, which looks like a bowling pin. But the pyramids of Giza, using this elaborate set of ramps, mathematically calculated. And we see these ramps that go up. And again, it took 200,000 men 20 years to build this one pyramid. It had a casing on the top that came down over it. And it had passageways in and around it where one could walk. I've been in there many times. Of course, you have to, you know, make sure you're pants and your wallet is solid because people pickpocket you when you go to bend down sometimes. But can you imagine this tunnel, this all this weight of this pyramid? And yet the Egyptians some 2,500 years ago knew how to build and construct this great pyramid of Giza. I took this picture that's down on the right, and you can see that each block is still standing there. There is no cement in this great pyramid. The Europeans call it the Pyramid of Cheops. Some call them the pyramids of the Giza Plateau or the Great Pyramid of Giza. And then there's another name they call the same pyramid. They call it the Pyramid of Khufu. Here you see, and I've taken pictures, and sometimes I go up two or three levels, but that's as far as I go. But look at the casing, and that covered the entire pyramid structure. And a mile away, I am standing outside looking toward the Great Pyramid of Giza. Oh, some 1,200 feet up, and you can see, can't even see the people who I'm about a mile away from the Great Pyramid of Giza. My group likes to climb, and you could climb if you go there, and I'm hoping all of you will get a chance to travel to Egypt and to climb the Great great pyramid of Egypt. Here we are on the modern Nile River. Now, the Egyptians believed their cemeteries are always on the right side because they believed as the sun rises in the east, which is on the left, it sets in the, and on the right, then their cemeteries or the pyramids are built on the right side of the Nile River. And of course, today, modern Cairo, you have Marriott, you have Sheratons, you have Holiday Inns, and then you have traffic jams, as you see down here. And they say, and I've been so nervous because in Egypt, in driving, they only have one rule, and that rule is no rule. And they just drive any kind of way, and there are accidents all over the place. But here are the Great Pyramids of Giza, constructed some 4,500 years ago. We see they use granite for their carvings. And granite is something, if you have a kitchen top, a countertop, you know, you can cut on that and never make a dent. And you see the face of Ramesses in the center. Ramesses II, one of the great builders of Egypt. He lived to be 92 years old, and they say he fathered over 141 children. And he was, in his time, he did more building. And of course, you can see his face, facial structures, a wide nose, larger lips. We know that he, in fact, was Negroid. Now, Pharaoh means big house. Big house. And we are going to study the Old Kingdom, the Middle Kingdom, and the New Kingdom. And in the New Kingdom particularly, we're going to look at Thutmose II, Thutmose III, who conquered more than Alexander the Great. We're going to look at Hatshepsut, who was the woman whose son became Pharaoh when he was 3, and she took over his throne, shaved her head or hair off, acted like a man till he was about 20-some years old. And he realized that his mother had taken his throne. But she had a great tomb built. Amenhotep III. And then we get down to names we recognize. Akhenaten, the one I showed you a few minutes ago. And we have Tutankhamun. And later on, the dynasties of Ramesses I and Ramesses II. And Ramesses II, his favorite wife was Nefertiti. Then came Alexander the Great and Ptolemy and all of the people there. Now, the artwork of Egypt is built around gods and goddesses, the afterlife. So the Osiris is the god of the universe. Isis was his wife. Horus was the son of Osiris and Isis. And we're going to talk about that mythology in just a few minutes. But Horus was the avenger of his father, Osiris. Why? Because Osiris was attacked by his brother, Seth. This is all mythology. And he was cut up into pieces and put on the Nile to float down the Nile. Isis became so upset and so emotional. And she went and got Anubis, who was the god of the underworld. And they got all the pieces of Osiris, put him back together again, and then they had a child. His name was Horus, we call the falcon god, and of course, he's called the pharaoh when he's living, and then when he dies, he becomes Osiris. We'll explain all of that a little bit later, but Egyptian gods and goddesses that I want you to be familiar with, and follow me in the handout, Osiris, god of the universe, Isis, the wife of Osiris and mother of Horus. Horus, the falcon god, who is the son of Osiris and Isis. And Seth, who is the evil brother of Osiris, who killed him, cut up his body, let him float down the Nile. And then it was Isis and Anubis who rescued these parts, put it back together again, and then it was Horus, who was born. Anubis is known as the jackal god. And you can see, you see Anubis coming for you. You better back up and leave, because it's time for you to go into the upper, into the underworld. They also had a goddess of truth and balance. Her name was Ma'at. It was really a system. And Ma'at represents the ideas of law and order and truth. Ma'at translates that which is straight. And please note, her wings would stretch out and you are able to see her. And so it implies anything that is true, ordered, or balanced. And that's the way Egypt was seen. Known for giant wings, and then there's a tall, straight feather on the top of her head. Remember that, that's Ma'at. So when we look at Egyptian mythology, the Ka is really the spirit of a person. And when a person dies, the Egyptians believe the Ka wanders until a mummy is made. And then in order for the person to exist in the afterlife, then there must be a mummy. So it's translated into like spirit or soul of a person. And that came into existence when one was born. And then you would meet their spirit or their soul in the afterlife. So Egyptians believed that the Ka had to be there or a person could not function in the afterlife. And in the afterlife, they believed that you had offerings of food and drink, and they would play games, and we will see when we see the other. So Egyptians believed in life after death, everlasting life. They believed in one case in monotheism, that was Akhenaten. And their architecture, they believed, was the resting place of pharaohs and kings and queens, and of course, high prestige politicians. And of course, they believed in the afterlife, and that they would go over the Nile every night, coming from the east to the west, and they would have celebrations and live forever. Now, when a person died and they were doing the embalming process, they used what we would call the canoptic jars. They would remove the organs, specific organs, from the body. Now, they left the heart in because they recognized that the heart was the central operating system. So that was very important for them to recognize, and they left the heart in the body. They removed the brain, and it sounds hideous, but they used to pull the brain through the nose and they would throw it away. They didn't understand what it was for. But then they would save in these canoptic jars the organs. And of course, each represented one of the four sons of Horus. So in order for a person to live in the afterlife, these four canoptic jars had to be placed in the mummy's presence, containing the deceased person's organs. So they would be, one, the intestines, two, the stomach, three, the lungs, and four, the liver. And here you see on the left a picture of the canoptic jars. Then comes some terminology you should know. For instance, a necropolis is a city of the dead. And in the Valley of the Kings, it was very hard to find tombs because the problem they had in Memphis was they were all robbed. When they had the pyramid, everyone would figure there's a whole lot of treasure in there. So many of the tombs were pilfered. Sometimes the people who were building the tombs would make a map, and then they'd sell it to a person afterwards. And as soon as the person died, they went in and took all the gold and silver. And of course, in Nubia was known for its gold. I'm telling you, they just, gold came out of Nubia, and everyone wanted to conquer Nubia and the Nubians and the Libyans. So, during the time of Luxor, a necropolis was the city of the dead where they found Tutankhamun's tomb. It was Howard Carter who found his tomb, and one of the workers found one of the steps, and they were looking for 16 steps, and Lord Carnarvon had given his sponsorship, and they found this shrine. Now, this is not solid gold. What they would do is melt down gold, and then they would put the gold on top of acacia wood in which it would not deteriorate. So what you're looking at here is real gold, but it was liquefied and placed on here. So again, the Egyptians gave us a lot. They gave us the calendar, 365-day calendar that we know today. Two, all kinds of methods of mortuary science. They say that Dr. Martin Luther King, when he was assassinated, that the embalming of Dr. King was done in Egyptian form. And if you were to go into his grave or his tomb 5,000 years from now, you would see him as he looked on the day that he died. These were the embalming methods of the Egyptians. And of course, they developed sophisticated hydraulics, moving 70-ton monuments and stones, some 60 stories high. And there was papyrus paper, which enabled scholars to record the Bible and many other things. In the Dead Sea Scrolls in the Bible, some of the scrolls were written on animal skins and others written on papyrus paper. All kinds of perfumes. I went to a perfume factory in Cairo, and they had five large sort of like gallons of alcohol. Then they took these compounds, and most of the perfume is made up of these compounds, and just put a few drops of water in there, or this compound, excuse me, and they had enough perfume for 20 years. And just think, many Europeans have come in and sold this $100 an ounce. So how did the Egyptians make the first writing paper? Out of papyrus, the papyrus plant. On the left, it grew up in Goshen, which is going up the Nile. It looks like sugar cane. And they would cut it, and then they would cut it into strips, and then they would put it into water, soak it. Then they would bring it out, let it dry, and then they would weave it up and over. Then the next row would be over and up, over and up. Then they would take a mallet, and then they would bang it together to make what is known as papyrus paper, and it is something to see. So the Egyptians used gold leaf. They melted gold down. They used gold casting. They used alabaster, which looks like marble, but it's very heavy. Wood carving, topaz, ivory, and ebony wood. If you've ever tried to put a nail through ebony wood, you'd break the hammer and the nail because termites and all kinds of insects, it is a very strong wood and very hard to carve. And they would paint the tombs and walls and, of course, use granite. Limestone carving was a common thing. So let's just review the Great Pyramid of Cheops, these statistics again. One, it had approximately 2 million by 1,900,000 limestone blocks, and they weighed anywhere between 10 to 70 tons. It took 200,000 men 20 years to build one pyramid. It takes up 13 city blocks, and it rises some 60 stories high. It houses chambers and hallways, as I tried to show you, and there's absolutely no cement or binder holding it together. So what an adventure it is just to go and see the pyramids and to understand where the construction workers, where these people worked some 2,500 years ago, putting up ramps and, of course, building the Great Sphinx, which represents the king's head and the lion's body. When you go there and you go at night or you go anytime, you can see a light show. And I'm on one mountain, and on the other side is mountain. Then you see a bus over here. But here's the great Sphinx. And when you go and walk around it, you see it's a giant piece of sculpture. And then when you walk around it, you can see the body of a lion. And it was buried in the sand up to the neck until 1926, and then they restored it. But just look, this Giza plateau. Last but not least is the step pyramid of Saqqara. And prior to the pyramid of Giza, in other words, this step pyramid, you see me pointing, I'm about 5 miles away, was used as a tomb. And it was designed by a great architect by the name of Imhotep. Imhotep, if you study engineering and architecture, you have to study Imhotep because he was the person who designed the Great Step Pyramid. What did he do? They had a tomb that they call, and it's one level, a mastaba. And what they would do is stack one mastaba on top of another mastaba, and of course end up at the top. So they had some one, two, three, four, five levels of tombs or mastabas. And then of course they built these multiple levels, and it was Imhotep, the vizier to Pharaoh Djoser, DH, excuse me, Djoser, 2600 BC. And Djoser, that's how we pronounce it. The D and the J, we call it Djoser. And Imhotep designed and constructed the Great Pyramid of Saqqara. And his reputation is known as a wise builder. And you can see his characteristics were of Negroid extraction. This is the way it looks today, and it's still standing. But this is the way it looked when he designed it, a palace, something, and we're talking about 5,000 years old. So before we go into more on Tutankhamun, we're going to take a break here and go into the Egyptian video number two. After we have digested, I want you to look at your notes, look at your course, the syllabus that I've given you, and we're going to entertain some beautiful questions later on. But before we go into the next tape, which covers Tutankhamun, we hope you're enjoying this trip to Egypt, which is a great part